What's up, everybody? I'm Mickey Breeze, and this is my Q&A. So, a little bit of backstory. Not too long ago, I got to revisit my elementary slash middle school and reconnect with my photography slash videography and computer lab teacher. And what was really cool about it is that he's been keeping up with all of the moves I've been making as an artist and as a musician by listening to my material and keeping up with all the shows that I've been doing over the years. And it's been like 5 years since I've seen the dude. So he introduced me to his class of students. And what was really funny about it is that they all knew immediately who I was upon walking in. It's like I just come in the door and they're like, "Oh my God, it's DJ Mickey Breeze." And I'm just befuddled at the fact that they recognize me by my face, and I'm wondering how, and I look at a door he has in his classroom, and he has the oldest possible poster of me with my face on it, autographed by my mom originally, and he's been keeping them updated as well on all of my career moves since I was a middle schooler. And so he invited me back to do a bit of a production showcase or a DJ routine just to give the kids some insight as to what I do. But sadly, because of the quarantine, it never got to happen. So since we're all social distancing and riding it out from home, he's been keeping the kids occupied with projects and videos and, you know, really dope teachers content to keep them busy and also keep them entertained and keep them knowledgeable about whatever it is they want to do. So he commissioned me to make a couple of videos and a couple of songs to help out with connecting with the students and everything. And so they got to watch my last video about my whole studio walkthrough. And here's a couple of questions that they had for me. So let's get to it. What? So I started making beats when I was about 8 years old on a PSP. Oh, wrong color. There we go. But I got that PSP for my 8th birthday and started making beats on a software called Beaterator made by Rockstar Games and Timbaland, the producer, I think. But around age 10 was when I think I actually started wanting to DJ and perform rather than just, you know, make beats. So as a producer slash beat maker, I was really interested in showing my stuff to people, but without having to put it out. I wanted to be able to get up on stage and perform it live and remix it and do all that sort of stuff. And I thought, oh snap, being a DJ gets up on stage and plays beats all the time. And I figured it was the most cool, live, dynamic way to be able to play my stuff in front of an audience and add a performance element to it as well. So the name Mickey Breeze actually comes from my full name. My real name, my real full name is McKinley Breeze Maxwell West. So Breeze is like my actual legal middle name. And then Mickey is just an abbreviation of my first name, McKinley. And it was also my favorite cartoon character when I was a kid. Yes, and it was horrible. Let me tell you why. I think it was in late February, early March of 2018. I had just come back from doing a couple of shows in LA. I had gotten back to Minnesota and was supposed to do a show the weekend after I got back, so that's Saturday. And then a week after that, I was supposed to go to South by Southwest down in Austin, Texas, and perform for an entire week down there. But as soon as I got back to the airport in Minnesota, I found my DJ equipment and it was destroyed. Buttons missing, the case looked like it exploded, the mixer was just missing all types of knobs and stuff like that. And I was like out of equipment. Like that was my only controller. That was my only means of playing anything and DJing any parties. I had to cancel my show for that Saturday when I got back in Minnesota, and I had to figure out the rental situation of equipment for going down to South by Southwest in Austin and playing on a whole new, whole different setup, which I honestly and truthfully think I kind of sucked at playing on. But yeah, it was bad. So Delta, if you're listening, we need to have a talk. I would say that this started becoming professional for me when I started getting consistent shows. It was weird trying to get my name known to people and be able to play certain places, especially due to my age. But when I actually started like networking with people and getting my name out and started getting shows on a daily, weekly, or monthly basis and everything like that, it became professional for me. You know, I had to start making contracts. I had to start putting out more content. I had to start being in the eye of a lot of the people that want to hire me a lot more and get to know what my business mind was and get to know what my goals and aspirations were. But it started becoming professional for me, and I think I really got into that professional mindset when it came to my business that I would say probably 12, 13. So if I had to do the math off the top of my head, say maybe 3 shows a week times 4 times 12 months a year, if I had to guess, I would say somewhere north of maybe like 150, possibly around the 200-ish mark. That sounds about right. Yeah, so probably about like 200 gigs a year. I'm pretty self-taught. When my mom first bought me my first DJ controller that I, you know, really wanted either for, I think it was a birthday present. I got really into it. I started doing my research on controllers. I started doing my research on like DJ culture and a lot of what it took to be a live performing DJ and everything like that. I got my scratch skills, I think, wrong, because if you ask any other DJ about what I do, I actually scratch backwards. So because of the fact that I didn't have somebody to teach me how to DJ, I ended up getting into that position a lot and just kind of stuck there. But yeah, primarily I'm self-taught. Yes, I do. Well, I live in my house and my studio is in my house, but I spend more time in my studio than I do in the rest of the house. My dog's name is Gidget, and she is a mini dachshund, aka a mini wiener dog. I love her very much. No, absolutely not. When I first started, this was more of a hobby than a profession. So I didn't want me or my mom to have to put a lot of money into something that I might not be able to use. And I still apply that mentality to a lot of the equipment I have today. But the best way to think about how I got equipment was, you buy equipment to use it to get money to buy more equipment. But no, I've never bought all of my equipment at once. So my current beat making software is Ableton. I started off, like I said, in my PSP production software called Beaterator, then moved up to another software called Reason, then moved up to another software, which I'm sure you're all familiar with, called GarageBand, and stayed there for a long time. Then upgraded to Logic, which is basically a big boy version of GarageBand, and then got into Ableton after a pretty decent amount of time just getting to learn how to use it and everything. I went to a production school for a while called Slam Academy, where they actually taught me how to use that software. And then once I graduated from Slam Academy, I started using it a lot in my live sets and my DJing. My current laptop is a 2012 MacBook Pro. I like that specific year. Because a lot of the newer MacBooks, I think 2014 and after, you can't take out and re-add your own parts into. So I did a couple upgrades of my own, and this is what I like so far. Primarily what my logo came from was a lot of my interests when I was little. I used to wear a lot of suits and ties, but more specifically, my favorite thing to wear when I was younger were bow ties. And I really liked, you know, being able to get dressed up and just go anywhere. And the 8-bit kind of facial thing that I had going on was because I started making beats, or I started producing off of video games. So I figured an 8-bit picture of me looking like a video game with a bow tie on. I wouldn't say I get tired of making music. I hit a couple dry spots, you know, where I might not be having ideas, or where I feel like some of the songs that I'm making start to sound the same. And it's good just to get, I guess, a break from making music for a couple seconds, but I usually find myself right back in the swing of things after not too long of a time. the biggest crowd I've ever played. Let's see. I played Soundset in 2019, and that was a pretty decent crowd. But I think my biggest ever show that I've played, or my biggest ever crowd, was at this festival in Fort Wayne, Indiana, called GOMAD. And it was just like lights and lasers and smoke and fog and a big conference center full of people. And it was really cool to be able to perform on stage and do it in front of a crowd that big. Yes, this is most definitely my full-time job. I'm a DJ, which means I play my music in front of a lot of people. I'm a producer, which means I have the ability to help people make their own music. And then I'm a teacher, which means I oftentimes get to teach people how to make music or put out music and how to use music to get themselves a career as well. So, yeah. Yes. Constantly. The only thing about messing up at shows is not a lot of times can people say that you messed up if they don't know what you're doing. A lot of times I'm DJing in front of a crowd of people who only hear the music and hear the vibe that I'm putting out. But as the performer, as somebody who knows what I'm doing in every raw detail, I consistently go like, oops, I missed a step, or oops, I might have did a transition wrong, or oops, I think I hit the wrong button at one point in time. But I'm pretty good at covering up my mistakes in a live show environment, and I think as long as I keep, you know, the crowd moving and keep everybody's attention on the energy in the room, it's never that big a deal. So as a bit of a closing statement, I just want to mention that in my last video, I didn't mention a lot of different brand names or different equipment names and everything, because there are a lot of different tools that you can use to get the desired result out of your music. And I don't want to make anybody feel like, oh, well, if I don't have a MacBook or if I don't have this equipment or that equipment name, I don't want anybody to feel like if they don't have that sort of stuff that they're doing it wrong. So I would say just put in your research for the type of equipment that you would like to use if you're interested in making music. Go out if you ever have the chance to, or if you ever are a hardworking person or have somebody who would love to support you in your creative endeavor. I would say make a small investment into whatever equipment you've done your research on and get to creating. But with that, I've been Mickey Breeze. Peace. Thank you.